Just in case you've not seen a map of it before, I know you have one in the back of your books somewhere, or in the front of your books. It's in the front. Yeah, it's in the front of this one. This map in here is drawn by Christopher Tolkien, based on one of his fathers. This is drawn by John Howe. If you do a search for this, you'll find a whole bunch of different variations of it. They're all pretty much the same because they're all rats. I didn't bring my pointer. They're all copied from Tolkien. When we get to The Lord of the Rings and The Hobbit and everything, if I were to put up a similar map and somehow overlay it on this, none of this would appear. Because everything that occurs in The Lord of the Rings and The Hobbit occurs west of here. Or excuse me, east of here. The Grey Havens is somewhere in this area in The Lord of the Rings. Okay? So all this gets covered up by water and such. That's the only reason I had that up there. So let me remove it. Yes. Lights. Are they coming up or are they not?
No.
Now they are. Okay, so I want to pick up with where we left off the other day. And where we left off was somewhere around page 6. We talked about when Eru Iluvatar tells the Ainur what they've created and essentially shows them what they've created, and he specifically addresses Melkor to tell him, you know, no matter what you do, you can't pull one up on me. Okay? And so he tells them, look at the bottom half of that page. Behold your music. And he showed to them a vision, giving to them sight where before there was only hearing, and they saw a new world made visible before them, and it was globed amid the void, and it was sustained therein, but was not of it. I don't really understand what that means, okay? Because it says it was in the void, but was not of it. So somehow this globed world was separated, okay? And even though it says globed here, we're not talking about Earth. The world that is globed within the void is the universe. Okay, so the universe is described kind of as a ball, and then the void is all around it. Okay? And it was sustained therein, what boat was not of it. And as they looked and wondered, this world began to unfold its history, and it seemed to them that it lived and grew. And when the Ainur had gazed for a while and were silent, Iluvatar said again, behold your music. This is your minstrelsy. Each of you shall find contained therein, amid the design I set before you, all those things which it may seem that he himself devised or added. You too, Melkor, will discover all the secret thoughts of thy mind, and will perceive that they are but a part of the whole and tributary to its glory. That is, all the little parts that Melkor wove in each time he strove against Iluvatar, Tolkien says, it's all tributary to its overall glory. Okay? And then the narrator says that Iluvatar spoke many other things and that they saw much, but they don't see everything. Okay? We're told, the Ainur know much of what was and is to come, and few things are unseen by them. But then we get a description of what is unseen. Some things there are that they cannot see, neither alone nor taking counsel together. For to none but himself has Iluvatar revealed all that he has in store. And in every age there come forth things that are new and have no foretelling, for they do not proceed from the past. In other words, in each new age, there are things that are seemingly new in the world. In other words, what the writer of Ecclesiastes says doesn't necessarily hold true for here. Writer of Ecclesiastes saying there's nothing new under the sun. Okay. And so it was that this vision of the world was played before them. Okay. Old newsreel. The Ainur saw that it contained things which they had not thought. Because what would the world, whether we here think specifically of Earth or Arda or the universe, what would the world be or mean if everything that was in it was foreseen or thought by the Ainur?
Morally pointless.
Morally pointless. It'd be a machine. That's it. There'd be no free will, in other words. Okay? And they saw with amazement the coming of the children of Iluvatar and the habitation that was prepared for them. Why? Did they see this with amazement? They didn't think of this. The children of Iluvatar did not enter the minds of the Ainur. That's why they're called the children of Iluvatar. And they perceived that they themselves and the labor of their music had been busy with the preparation of this dwelling, and yet knew not that it had any purpose beyond its own beauty. That is, while they're sitting there singing, making up their songs, Iluvatar has in his mind that all of this, let's say, you know, the point within it that is known as Arda, all of this has an even greater goal, which is the coming of the children of Iluvatar. Right? For the children of Iluvatar were conceived by him alone. Now keep in mind, the Ainur, if you have Eru up here, Iluvatar, and the Ainur down here, think of them as points. How much does each one of them see of the mind of Iluvatar? Just that sliver. Okay. Some of them see more than others. You have major Ainur and lesser Ainur. In fact, within the Ainur, you have two kind of groupings, which we'll talk about later. Okay. But none of them sees, obviously, the whole mind. Because if they were able to see the whole mind of God, they would be what? Thank you. It would be God. So, for the children of Iluvatar were conceived by him alone, and they came with the third theme. Well, what was the third theme? We go back to page 4. Iluvatar sits there. He listens to the music. It's got a nice beat. It's going along with it. And then Melkor starts to think, because to Melkor among the Ainur had been given the greatest gifts of power and knowledge. And he had a share in all the gifts of his brethren. So Melkor has got a little bit of each of these. So if anybody comes close to seeing the whole of the mind of Iluvatar, it's Melkor. Okay? And we're told he'd often gone off into the void looking for the imperishable flame. He wants to, you know, play with fire, as it were. Whole Prometheus myth. But he didn't find it. Why? Because it's with the Iluvatar. And so he now weaves these thoughts into the music. And they spread wider and they start to drown out the melodies, etc. The Iluvatar arises. Okay? Lifts up his left hand, and there's a new theme. Okay? Melkor's discord rises again. The Iluvatar rises again. Lifts up his right hand. This is another theme. This is the second theme. Finally, Iluvatar stands up, both hands, frown on his face. He's really pissed. Third theme. Okay? For the children of Iluvatar were conceived by him alone, and they came with the third theme. And were not in the theme which Iluvatar propounded at the beginning. And none of the Ainur had part in their making. That is, Melkor doesn't have a clue about these. But now, as the film is being rolled for them, they see the little people, to them, Okay, the children of Ilúvatar abounding around in the green forests and everything. And these are completely new. They're completely foreign to their ideas. Therefore, when they beheld them, the more they did love them. Most of the Ainur, let's say. Being things other than themselves. Remind you of anything that we've talked about previously? Things other than themselves. That's what Tolkien talks about with recovery. Recovery, that regaining of a clear view, or that gaining of clear sight, seeing things as other than ourselves. Because what happens when we start to see them as extensions of ourselves? We appropriate them and we lose love for them. In that passage in the fairy story essay, he's talking about our familiars, our families and such. So, the more they did love them, being things other than themselves, strange and free. Strange because they didn't have any part in their making. Totally foreign. Free, how? Wherein they saw the mind of Ilúvatar reflected anew. See, previously they saw the mind of Ilúvatar reflected when they would look at each other. Oh, you're this little aspect of Ilúvatar. You're this aspect. They look now at the children of Ilúvatar, and they think, wow, he's really got a sense of humor. And they learned yet a little more of his wisdom, which otherwise had been hidden even from them. So who are the children of Ilúvatar? Elves and men. What about hobbits? What about dwarves?
They come later.
Okay. Dwarves, a little later. Hobbits, not really sure when.
I'll put them in with men. They put themselves there.
Are they stunted men?
No,
they're not.
Travel size.
It's just, yeah, travel size. They're airport size. So we have elves and men, the firstborn and the followers. Okay. And amid all the splendors of the world, its vast halls and spaces, wheeling fires, Ilúvatar chose a place for their habitation in the deeps of time and in the midst of the innumerable stars. That's why all of this is essentially the universe. They haven't yet seen Arda, so to speak. Okay? And we go on and we get the description of this place. And I'm going to skip a couple paragraphs. The Ainur, next page, look upon the habitation set within the vast spaces of the world, which the elves call Arda, the earth. See, this, the universe, is what the narrator is calling the world, and set within that is Arda, or the earth. Their hearts rejoice in the light, etc., etc., etc. They observe the winds and the air, the stuff that Arda is made of. Okay? And it is said by the Eldar, that is the eldest of the elves, that in water there lives yet the echo of the music of the Ainur, more than in any substance else that is in this earth. And many of the children of Ilúvatar hearken still unsated to the voices of the sea, and yet know not for what they listen. That's kind of a pre-allusion, if you want, to Galadriel's warning Legolas when he leaves Lothlorien at the end of the Two Towers. Excuse me, at the end of the Fellowship of the Ring. Beware the sound of the sea. Because once he hears the sound of the sea, something will stir in his elvish blood that will want to take him back from Middle Earth to where the elves, I'm going to fudge a little here, originally came from. Even though they didn't originally come from Valinor, they originally came from Middle Earth. Okay? So then we get a description about Ulamo and the water and all that kind of stuff, which I'm going to skip. We're going to skip a whole lot. Page 9. After the break. And even as Ulmo spoke, and while the Ainur were yet gazing upon this vision, it was taken away and hidden from their sight. It seemed to them that in that moment they perceived a new thing. Sorry, I'm having an epiphany. I need to make a note of that. Darkness comes. If you're very familiar with the Lord of the Rings, you'll remember in the chapter at the house of Tom Bombadil, Frodo is talking with Tom, and Frodo asks him, "Who are you, Master?" And Tom Bombadil says, something like, "Don't you know me yet? Who are you, yourself, alone, nameless?" And then he goes on and talks about himself. He says, "I was here before the big people came." And he keeps going on and says, "I was here before the darkness came." Okay.
I always thought he meant Sauron.
See, one thing you have to understand about Tom Bombadil is he doesn't belong in the Lord of the Rings. The stories of Tom Bombadil had been written before the publication of the Lord of the Rings. The adventures of Tom Bombadil had been written and published before the Lord of the Rings. He just takes Tom Bombadil because he, you know, has him like sitting on the shelf and drops him in the middle of the Lord of the Rings. Okay, it's been one of the biggest critical questions: is who is he? What is he? You know, because he puts the ring on and doesn't do anything. Frodo puts the ring on. He's like, "Hey, Frodo, come back here." He can still see Frodo. Okay, we'll talk more about Tom Bombadil later. So they keep going on. They see this vision and stuff. And we're told after the darkness comes in, but they have become enamored of the beauty of the vision and engrossed in the unfolding of the world which came there to being. And their minds were filled with it. For the history was incomplete and the circles of time not full wrought when the vision was taken away. In other words, they saw time not like this. They saw time starting here, coming around, but they don't see how it all finishes. They don't see the conclusion. I knew her. In other words, they are even in the dark about how it all works out, or if it all works out. As far as they know, this might be the Norse version of time, and it might end up with Ragnarok and Eru gets defeated. Okay? Don't think so, but so we're told. And some have said that the vision ceased ere the fulfillment of the dominion of men and the fading of the firstborn. That it ceased before the fourth age of Middle Earth. You know, the Lord of the Rings ends with the end of the third age and its beginning of the fourth. You don't get any of this in the films. And it's the beginning of the fourth age, which is the age of men, which is the age when elves and dwarves and hobbits and all those other people go away, and it's essentially us now. Wherefore, though the music is over all, the Valar have not seen as with sight the later ages or the ending of the world. Okay? So they don't even know what's going to happen at the end. They do know what's going to happen in the first age, the second age, and I think it's safe to say probably most of, if not all, of the third age. How do they know what's going to happen? They've seen it. Okay? So, Eru addresses them, and he says, "I know the desire of your minds, that what you have seen should verily be." That is their desire. They want to see that what they have seen actually comes to fruition. It's actually made real. In other words, what they've seen so far is essentially, go back to the fairy story essay, it's the image. There now needs to be an art to turn that image into subcreation. So he says that you want to see it, that it should verily be, not only in your thought, but even as ye yourselves are, and yet other, that is, separate, distinct from you. Therefore I say, Ea. This is, you know, his Elvish version of Fiat Lux. Let there be light. Ea. Let these things be, and I will send forth into the void the flame imperishable. It shall be at the heart of the world, and the world shall be, and those of you that will may go down into it. So what do you need in order to make things really, totally, completely, fully separate from yourself? In other words, to be a creator. You need the flame imperishable. That's how Eru can make these things separate. He says, I'll put the flame imperishable in the midst of them. And that's what will make them be. Okay? So why was Melkor out searching for the flame imperishable? He wants to be a real creator. He's tired of being a sub-creator. Okay? And then Eru says, and if you want, you can go down into the world. In other words, you can leave here and dwell there. And suddenly the Ainur saw far off a light, as it were a cloud with a living heart of flame. They knew that this was no vision only, but that Iluvatar had made a new thing, Ea, the world that is. And so some decide to stay with Iluvatar, where beyond the confines of the world. Notice that phrase? It's the exact same phrase that Tolkien uses when he talks just before the epilogue about joy. That the eucatastrophic ending of a fairy tale gives you a glimpse of joy beyond the confines of the world. Okay? I don't think it's an accident. But others, among them some of the greatest and the most fair, leave Iluvatar and go down into the world. And when they enter into the world, their names change. Doesn't mean their essence or anything like that changes. It's just that when they're in the world, they're no longer called the Ainur. So now let's stop. Let's say this is the boundary line between wherever Eru and such are, and this is the world. The world. Down here, these become Valar and Maiar. Maiar are like, you know, second tier Valar. They're varsity, they're JV. Okay? So they go down into the world. And when they enter into Ea, they are astounded and at a loss. For it was as if naught had yet was yet made which they had seen in vision. They kind of expected that when they saw that point of light, everything they had seen in the vision would be there. And instead they get down here and what do they find? Cold piece of rock with water. And so what is it their job to do?
Fix it up.
To make the rock alive, to fix it up, to spruce it up. Okay? So we get descriptions of their labors and such. Chief part taken by Manwë and Ule and Ulmo. Melkor too, he goes down also. And then we're given this nice little description. Okay? Top of page 11. When therefore earth was yet young and full of flame, Melkor coveted it. Coveted it. And he said to the other Valar, this shall be my own kingdom, and I name it unto myself. So what does he claim of the world? All of earth. That's what he's saying. You guys can never, I want this part. Manwë. Don't think so. He's the brother of Melkor in the mind of Iluvatar. Okay. also the chief instrument of the second theme that Iluvatar had raised up against the discord of Melkor. So you've got Iluvatar, Melkor, who shares most of Iluvatar's mind of all the Ainur, and then Manwë. And when Melkor starts raising his discord, it's almost like Manwë goes, okay, take it over to Iluvatar, says, take it over Manwë. And Manwë, you know, amps up his volume. And those two strive. So what happens? Manwë called unto himself many spirits, both greater and less. They came down into the fields of Arda and aided Manwë, lest Melkor should hinder the fulfillment of their labor forever, and earth should wither ere it flowered. So what do we see literally at the founding of earth?
Conflict.
Discord. Good and evil. That simple theme, that escapist theme, the theme that people, you know, erudite, pointy-head scholars and such today say, oh, how trite, it's been overdone. Well, there's a reason why it's trite and been overdone. Because if you accept, let's say, this kind of cosmology, it's there from the beginning, okay? So Manwë says, no, you don't get this. It's not yours. Others have labored here also. And there's strife. Melkor withdraws, goes into other regions, okay? And so the Valar take to themselves shape. They give themselves bodies. And what might we call Manwë in our language, or, you know, Greek or Roman?
Zeus, Jupiter.
And his wife?
Hera.
Juno or Hera, okay? And we could go all the way on down the line, you know, the Aule would be something like Hephaestus or Vulcan, okay? All the way through. So, they give themselves bodies. They work with love for Arda and such. And we're told they don't need this raiment, these bodies that they created for themselves. But they use it only as raiment, so that yet we may be naked and suffer no loss of our being. Therefore, the Valar can walk, if they will, unclad, that is, without body, as it were. And even then the Eldar cannot clearly perceive them, though they be present. But when they desire to clothe themselves, the Valar take upon them forms, some as of male, some as of female, for the difference of temper they had even from their beginning. Notice, from their beginning, they are not gendered. But there is a difference, Tolkien says, of temper. He doesn't mean attitude. Okay? It's of creation. And it is but bodied forth in the choice of each. All right? So we're going to skip a bunch. Melkor is always like a flame. And then we go to the Valaquinta. Okay? Which is about the beginning of the Vala and such. So, turn to page 18. Now, we're not going to go through in the next 2 days, because we have today and whatever the next day is, Thursday. We're not going to go through each of the individual stories, simply put, because that would be in a semester's course. Okay. I am going to hit a couple of the more major stories, for example, Beren and Lúthien, because that's very particular to Tolkien. Go to his gravesite today. Have you been there?
I have been there.
You have been there? Go to his gravesite today and you'll see his headstone. And it says, John Ronald Reuel Tolkien, birth dates, death dates, Beren. Edith Pratt Tolkien, birth date, death date, Lúthien. Okay? The love story of Beren and Lúthien is he and his wife's love story, or his and his wife's love story. Okay, so of the Valar, we find out there are seven lords of the Valar, and there are seven queens of the Valier. Okay, Manwë and Melkor, and then with Manwë, his wife, so to speak, is Varda, Lady of the Stars. Where do we see her in Lord of the Rings? Aleobereth Gilthoniel Monotonoth Imperial, or something like that. Okay? So what are they doing every time an elf or Frodo or Sam suddenly starts spouting off in Elvish? Aleobereth Gilthoniel. It's a prayer. It's an invocation. It's, help me, Mary, Queen of Heaven. That's essentially what it is. Okay? And then we get all the other, we have Ulmo, Lord of the Waters, etc. He dwells by himself, you know, because he's all wet and stuff. And then Aule, who's the smith. And then you have the Fanturi, Mondos and Lorien. Okay? Namo, Yvonne, the giver of fruits and such. Again, I'm just hitting over the names. But after those, page 23. All right. You have a kind of a summation of the names of the Valar and the Valier. Okay? I don't want to look at that last paragraph before the break, before the Maiar, with the sentence, and if little is here said of all that the Eldar once knew, that is as nothing compared with their true being, which goes back into regions and ages far beyond our thought. Among them nine were of chief power and reverence. One is removed from their number and eight remain. The Eretar. So, you know, Tolkien loves creating names. So you have Ainur, who become Valar, who become Valar and Valieri, or Valier, who become the Eretar, the High Ones of Arda, Manwë and Varda, Ulmo, Yavanna and Aule, Mondos, Nienna, and Orome. Okay? The one removed from their number? Melkor. And then we get the Maiar. Well, who are the Maiar? Helpers. Servants and helpers. Their number's not known to the elves. Few have names of any of the languages of men. But we do hear some of them. Page 24. Ilmare, the handmaid of Varda. That is, she helps Varda. Eanwë, the banner bearer and herald of Manwë. Okay. Ase and Uinen are a couple more. Melian, she's going to be important because she's the mother of Luthien and therefore a grandmother of Elrond and therefore Arwen and a grand, I don't remember what the exact lineage is, aunt, maybe grandmother somehow removed for Aragorn. Okay, wisest of the Maiar was Olorin.
Gandalf.
Gandalf the Grey, Mithrandir, as the elves call him. He too dwelt in Lorien, but his ways took him off into the house of Nienna, and of her he learned pity and patience. What was Nienna's thing?
Weeping.
Sorrow. Healing. Okay? In later days, talking about Olorin, he was the friend of all the children of Iluvatar, took pity on their sorrows. Those who listened to him awoke from despair and put away the imaginations of darkness. Can you think of a single character in The Lord of the Rings who awakes from despair and puts away the imaginations of darkness?
Theoden?
Yes. Theoden, King of the Golden Hall, Lord of Rohan. He almost uses those exact same words, too, after Gandalf comes and cleans him, clears him. And then we get the enemies. Morgoth, the artist formerly known as
Melkor.
Okay, takes on a new name. From splendor he fell through arrogance to contempt for all things save himself. A spirit wasteful and pitiless. Kind of sounds like a couple of characters we will meet in Lord of the Rings. Okay? Because they are mere shadows of Melkor. We'll talk about them as we go in. Dreadful, next page, before we get to the actual Quintus Silmarillion. Dreadful among these spirits, that is, the spirits who hearkened to the voice of Melkor, were the, Valoralkar, the scourges of fire that in Middle-earth were called Balrogs. Okay? They are also Maiar. That tells you why. I'm giving a whole bunch of stuff away here in case you haven't read Lord of the Rings, but I think all of you have seen the films, in which case I need to clear your minds. Need to do an exorcism, as it were. Yeah. Have to exercise your mind of that foulness. The scene in Two Towers, when Gandalf puts a spell on the door, on Balin's chamber room in Moria, and he says, I've been tested, there's something there, I've not met in a long, long, long... Okay, he's talking about you got to go all the way back to some of the action we see in here, where Balrogs are much more active. Okay? What else? Among those of his spirits that have names, the greatest was that spirit whom the Eldar called Sauron, or Gorthaur the Cruel. In his beginning, he was of the Maiar of Aule. Now, what does Aule do? What's his shtick?
Make stuff.
He's the smith. He's the maker. Well, what does Sauron do?
Makes the ring.
Makes the ring? What else does he make?
Orcs.
Orcs.
He makes orcs. Does he make them?
Corrupts.
He corrupts what?
Elves.
Okay? Because he can't really make on his own because he doesn't have the flame of perishable. So, takes us to the Quintus Silmarillion. And I'm gonna gloss over a whole bunch here. Until we get to Fëanor and the Unchaining of Melkor. So, the beginning of days and all of that. Who is woken first?
Elves.
Which is why they're called? The firstborn. Where are they woken? Awakened.
Beneath the stars.
Yeah, beneath the stars, it's nighttime. Okay, but that's not really quite accurate. It's not nighttime. Because there's no sun yet. It's just the way the world is. There's no sunlight. Because the sun hasn't been made. The moon hasn't been made. Okay. They are in what will later be called Middle Earth. East of Beleriand. They've got to make their way, you know, if I put that map back up. Wake up. Yes, take. Yes, do your funny light thing. Let's have a projector, please. Screen. On every room, different controls. Sometimes you have to tell the projector to actually come on, sometimes it actually comes on its own. Let's see here. We have the elves wake up, and we hear some of the names of the first ones that wake up. I want to find the exact place. I've got another copy of this book, and I've got it marked in the map there. So, I won't worry about it.
50 is the names of the fathers.
What page?
50. The good way of my.
Yeah. I thought there was a spot that gave us the name of the area where they actually.
45 has the word beginning.
I'm not seeing that.
A starlit mirror of soon beginning, water awakening. It's like two pages after the beginning, the coming of the elves.
I'm just not seeing it on this map.
Oh.
Okay.
Well, it should be way down on the other side of this.
Yeah, map. I think it is. I'm thinking of another map.
It's where they
Tolkien.
Wait, so what?
Okay, so go back to, so we have the coming of the elves. Hold on, lost my place here. After all the elves wake up and such. Sorry, I lost my place again. Actually, we're not going to be able to skip. Shoot. Okay, so the Valar of the beginning of days. We'll go back there. Chapter 1 in the Quintus Silmarillion. The Valar take rest after they do all of their work. Put the screen up. Lighting. Back up. And Yavanna plants the seeds and everything, and we have the two trees. Okay? What are the two trees? What are they for?
They're to light the Arda.
There's a light Arda, kind of a greater light and a lesser light. So they kind of serve the purpose of the sun and moon, but they're not the sun and moon. Okay? So while the Valar are doing their stuff, what is Melkor doing? Page 31. Yeah, he's building, well, he's not building his own army at this point, but he's building a fortress, okay, Utumno, in the north of the Middle-earth area of Beleriand, right? And so he builds it, he fortifies it, because he's getting ready for battle, okay? Again, I'm skipping a whole bunch. We have Valinor prepared, and they're getting ready for the coming of the elves. The two trees grow, page 33, Telperion and Lorelin. And we get the description of the trees. The Valar are looking out for the coming of the firstborn. And page 37, let's say, where the paragraph beginning, now all is said concerning the manner of the earth and its rulers, blah, 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 blah. Elves and men are the children of Luvatar, since they understood not fully that theme by which the children entered into the music. None of the Ainur dared to add anything to their fashion, for which reason the Valar are to these kindreds rather their elders and their chieftains than their masters. In other words, the Valar do not consider themselves to be what?
Gods.
Exactly. They consider themselves to be like, you know, uncles. They're going to help guide them, direct them, etc. Okay? Well, except for one. And if ever in their dealing with elves and men, the Ainur have endeavored to force them when they would not be guided, seldom has this turned to good, howsoever good the intent. Now, why does Tolkien include this?
It's why they're not overtly active.
It's why they're not overtly active in the world? What else? What happens when we do see the Valar try to...
The elder
go into the Noldor. They attempt to bring the Noldor to their Valinor.
Okay.
And when that happens, all Noldor.
Well, there is that, but the Noldor do come.
Right.
Okay. It's a little bit after that.
That it causes the children, it causes the elves or the men to rebel against them?
Yeah.
Right.
Okay. This is where we're getting to Feanor. Okay, what happens to, I don't want to go further. Pick up on 38. Okay, this is now whoever our narrator is. Our narrator is telling us some of this background stuff. Okay. Iluvatar tells the Valar, "Behold, I love the earth, which shall be a mansion for the Quindi and the Atani." Quindi, the elves, Atani, us, men and women. "But the Quindi shall be the fairest of all earthly creatures. They shall have and shall conceive and bring forth more beauty than all my children. And they shall have the greater bliss in this world." In other words, the elves shall have a greater beautiful touch, let's say, a greater beautiful gift. Okay? "And they shall have the greater bliss." They'll enjoy the world more. "But to the Atani I will give a new gift." Doesn't say what it is. Just says, "Therefore he willed that the hearts of men should seek beyond the world and should find no rest therein." It's like Eru Iluvatar is channeling St. Augustine. You have to understand a little bit about St. Augustine. St. Augustine said, after he converted to Christianity, okay, that everyone has a, this is his language, not mine, God-sized hole in their being. And what everyone attempts to do is to fill that God-sized hole, that God-sized void. And they try to fill it with a variety of things. St. Augustine talks about his own previous life. He was a pretty wild guy. And they try to fill it with sex. Or they try to fill it with booze. Or they try to fill it with drugs. Or they try to fill it with money. They try to fill it with success. None of them work. Why? Because it's not a sex-sized hole or a booze-sized hole. Only thing that could fill the hole is God. "Therefore, he willed that the hearts of men should seek beyond the world and should find no rest therein. But they should have a virtue to shape their life." What does virtue mean there? The real meaning of the word virtue, it's power. Okay? It's power. That's why faith is a virtue. Hope is a virtue. Love is a virtue. Loyalty is a virtue. Camaraderie is a virtue, etc. Okay? Because those are powers that lie within. "But they should have a virtue to shape their life amid the powers and chances of the world beyond the music of the Ainur, which is as fate to all things else." So alone, this is key, alone of all the creatures, let's say this is Earth now, of all the creatures that inhabit Earth, only humanity is free to shape its destiny. So, what does that say about Galadriel? What is Galadriel?
She's an elf.
She's an elf. She's an old elf. Really, really, really old. Doesn't look anything, well, I don't know, maybe she does, like Kate Blanchett. But she's Kate Blanchett about a bazillion years old. Okay? She is the daughter of the first awakened elves. And that's not like, you know, Genesis, so-and-so lived 1,000 years, and then the implication is they wake up, they find each other, they marry, they have children, and she's like awakened 30 years, 40 years, maybe 100 years after the very first elf wakes up. She's old, okay? What does that mean for her? The music of the Ainur is what, he says? is as fate. Well, what's fate?
Inescapable,
exactly. There's nothing you can do. Okay? Does that mean every little move she makes was fated for her? No.
No, because he said that the children of the Luvatar were new and not perceived by the Ainur and the Muzan.
Exactly. Exactly. Okay?
So she can still take the ring or turn it down.
But exactly. She does have a choice. But the music of the Ainur does shape some of the existence of elves. Just not all of it. Okay? What about, and this is why I brought in hobbits. What about hobbits? They aren't men. Okay? What about dwarves? Okay? Several years ago, I was working on, I'd hoped to work on, a scholarly edition of Tolkien's On Fairy Stories. And I was at the Bodleian Libraries in Oxford, and I had Tolkien's manuscripts out in front of me, and I'm sitting here dutifully copying them out, etc. A couple other people got permission before I did to publish the book. And I'm copying them out, and Tolkien has this one comment in one of the manuscripts. It doesn't get included in the final version of the essay at all. But he's writing about the fate of elves. And he says, the fate of elves is the fate of the world. That is, when the end comes, okay, and the world is destroyed. He's talking Christian cosmology here. Okay, and the world is destroyed, and heaven and earth are made anew. The elves, they're gone. They're totally gone. Why? Because they are creatures of this world only. They are tied to this world. Their fate is bound up totally with the fate of this world. Humans are not. It's part of the gift that we read here that humans have. So go on to the next paragraph.
Wolves are furniture, humans are tenants.
Yeah, kind of. But Iluvatar knew that men, being set amid the turmoils of the powers of the world, would stray often and would not use their gifts in harmony. And so he said, these two in their time shall find that all that they do redounds at the end only to the glory of my work. And yet what else does that mean? Yet the elves believe that men are often a grief to Manwë, who knows most of the mind of Iluvatar. For it seems to the elves that men resemble Melkor most of all the Ainur, although he's ever feared and hated them, even those that served him. In other words, it's almost like Melkor knows something about us that we don't know about ourselves. Okay? It is one with this gift of freedom that the children of men dwell only a short space in the world alive and are not bound to it. And depart soon whither the elves know not. See, when elves die, where do they go? They go to the recycling center, the Halls of Mandos, where they are recycled. They stay there for a while, and then whoop, they come back to Middle-earth.
So you can get two Glorfindels.
They're reincarnated. Well, it's not actually that there are two. Well, there are two different.
Two.
Yeah, a lot of elves have the same names.
Yeah.
It's kind of like, you know, Joe Smith. Okay. But it's more that they leave, they go off to the Halls of Mandos, which are where? They're in Valinor, okay, or in Aman. And then what? Where is Valinor even? Where is the Blessed Realm? It's here. Not here, Earth. It's here, the world. It's somewhere physically in the universe. Where is it that men go after they die? Boop, they pop out. They go elsewhere. Not even Manwë knows what happens to men. Okay? They depart soon whither the elves know not. Whereas the elves remain until the end of days, and their love of the earth and all the world is more single and more poignant, therefore, and as the years lengthen, ever more sorrowful. Why? The elves die not till the world dies. Unless they are slain or waste in grief. That's kind of interesting. They can die essentially of a broken heart. Doesn't have to be a romantic broken heart. Neither does age subdue their death, blah, 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 blah. But dying, they gather to the halls of Mandos and Valinor, whence they may in time return. Reincarnation. But Tolkien's supposed to be a Christian. What is he, some kind of wacko? You know, I can just see fundamentalists coming out of the wall. Actually, I used to have debates with a few on a Christianity and literature listserv many years ago. But the sons of men die indeed and leave the world. They don't go off to the halls of Mandos. They don't go off to, you know, the Elysian fields. No. Wherefore they are called the guests or the strangers. Death is their fate, comma, the gift of Iluvatar. Okay? Gifts are supposed to be things you enjoy getting, right? Yes, that's the correct answer, yes. The gift of Iluvatar, which as time wears, even the powers shall envy. Who are the powers? Manwë, Varda, Yavanna, Ulme, Aule. But Melkor has cast his shadow upon it, death, and confounded it with darkness, and brought forth evil out of good, and fear out of hope. Death ought to be something hoped for. Okay? This is the whole purpose, by the way. Other class. This is the whole purpose of the Harry Potter novels. The entire purpose of them is to teach Harry how to die well. That is the overarching theme, I'm convinced. I've got a book going in the back of my mind that I'm too lazy to sit down and write. Okay? That he has to learn how to die well, which means, ultimately, he has to learn to accept death. And accept it honorably, not being dragged kicking and screaming to it. Okay? As we will see people in this book, excuse me, Lord of the Rings, we will see people who die well, and we will people who die not so well. Okay? Yet of old the Valar declared to the elves of Valinor that men shall join in the second music of the Ainur. Whereas Iluvatar has not revealed what he purposes for the elves after the world's end, and Melkor has not discovered it. So the Valar has said, "Psst, come here. I've got a secret for you. Don't be dissing men. Because they're going to take part in the second singing of the Ainur." Well, what happened with the first singing of the Ainur? Creation of the world. So what's going to happen with the second? The implication is creation of an even better world. What are you elves going to do? They don't know. All they know is they're tied to this world. They don't know what happens. Which is why, when we get to the tale of Beren and Lúthien, which is why it is so momentous. I mean, you really have to understand the power of the decision Lúthien makes when she swears off her elvishness and says, "I will take the part of my husband," and says, "I will be human," which means not only will she die, but in the long distant future, she will never see, according to what they know, her kin again. She'll never see her father. Her mother, who knows? She's a Maya. You know, what happens to Maya? I don't think they get recycled because they're essentially spirit beings, okay? And we're told that Melkor has not discovered it. So he doesn't even know. So we get Aule and Yavanna. We get the making of a variety of things. We're going to skip a bunch. Coming of the elves and the captivity of Melkor, okay? So Melkor makes his fortress, Utumno, and Sauron makes his, Angband. Nice Germanic-sounding word. Why? Well, because it's essentially Anglo-Saxon. Ang means iron. Band means bound. Iron bound. Okay? You're going to see that this in another context later with a character that comes up in The Lord of the Rings. The captain of the Nazgul, whose real name is the Witch King of Angmar.
Angrist.
Okay, and there's also Angrist, the knife. Okay, so you have the coming of the elves and the captivity of Melkor. So the elves wake up, and they're brought to Valinor. I'm going to skip a whole bunch here. And we have the first sundering of the elves, because some don't want to come and some do come. So those that go, go. And they make their way to Valar. Then we get chapter 4 of Thingol and Melian. Okay, Thingol, a lord of the elves, weds Melian, a Maia. And then we get chapter 5 of the Eldamar and the princes of the Eldalia. And we hear the names of the leaders, essentially. Page, in mine, it's page 63. I don't know what page it is on yours. This is 1, 2, 3, 4, about 5 or so pages into that chapter. Finwë was king of the Noldor. Sons of Finwë were Fëanor, Fingolf, and Finarfin. Okay? Fëanor is the mightiest in skill of word and of hand, more learned than his brothers, blah, 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 blah. He's got 7 sons. They all get named. Okay. And then we're told how the Teleri come to the land of Aman. And we get chapter 6, Fëanor and the Unchaining of Melkor. And we're told at the end of the chapter that if Melkor hates any of the elves more than any others, who is it?
Fëanor.
It's Fëanor. Fëanor is a great maker. Melkor really isn't. Okay? But we're told Fëanor is kind of like Melkor. Driven at the very last paragraph of that page 71, or the last page of that chapter. Fëanor is driven by the fire of his own heart only, working ever swiftly and alone. He has to aid and sought the counsel of none that dwelt in Aman, great or small, save only a little of his wife. So he's kind of wrapped up in himself. Okay? And then we have the beginning of the next chapter, where Fëanor makes the Silmarils. Now, what are the Silmarils?
The remnants of the trees.
Okay.
The great jewels that have captured the light of the trees and give light unto themselves.
They're not, at the point that he creates them, they're not the remnant of the trees, because the trees are still alive. But he is able to capture the light of the two trees and put them in the Silmarils. Okay? And everybody's totally amazed. I mean, the second page. All who dwelt in Aman were filled with wonder and delight at the work of Fëanor. Varda hallowed the Silmarils, so that thereafter no mortal flesh, nor hands unclean, nor anything of evil will might touch them, but it was scorched and withered. And Mandos foretold that the fates of Arda, earth, sea, and air lay locked within them. Okay? And what does Fëanor essentially say about them? He says something very similar to, not exactly, but very similar to something Gollum says. Mine, exactly. My precious, you know, because he makes them. So, skipping a whole bunch. How does Valinor get darkened? What does Melkor do? He inspires Ungoliant to attack the trees, and what does she do? She sucks the light out. Of course, it's not nice for her. Okay, who's a descendant of Ungoliant?
Ungoliant.
Shelob, okay. So the trees are dead. Light falls, darkness falls upon Valinor. Why? There's no sun and moon. So the only light they have are the light of the stars. Okay? But what can Yavanna do to the two trees?
She was
going
to try to jumpstart them.
She could jumpstart them. Get the right jumper cables and the right battery source. She could put the light back into them if she had Silmarils. But Feanor won't let her have them. He says they're his. Okay? Thus we get the first sundering of elves and the Valar. That same page. Chapter 9, Flight of the Noldor. Second page. First page, Yavanna says, the light of the trees has passed away, but they are in the Silmarils. Foresighted was Feanor. I can make the trees shine again. Manwë asked him, what do you say, Feanor? Will you let us use the light? Feanor says, for the less, even as for the greater, there is some deed that he may accomplish but once only. And in that deed his heart shall rest. It may be that I can unlock my jewels, but never again shall I make their light. And if I must break them, I shall break my heart, and I shall be slain first of all the Eldar in Aman. So what's he saying about himself? I'll die.
And I'm the best elf there is.
Okay. What attitude is Feanor not willing to take? Or what position, what stance is he not willing to take, not only for Valinor and Aman, but for all Middle-earth? He's not willing to sacrifice himself for the good of everybody else. Okay? Mondos, not the first. They're like, what? Huh? What do you mean? Mondos know something they don't. Okay? And then Mondos keeps speaking. Feanor thinks, and then he finally says, this thing I will not do of free will, but if the Valar will constrain me, then shall I know indeed that Melkor is of their kindred, guilt by association. So he's just said, if you make me do this, then I know that you really are like Melkor. So that kind of ties Manwë's proverbial hand. Mando says, thou hast spoken. What does that mean whenever Mando says something like that? It's kind of like Yul Brynner in the old The Ten Commandments film. You know, so let it be written, so let it be done. It means it has force of fate, essentially. Mando says, you've said it. And what that means is now a whole bunch of actions are going to start rippling from these words of Feanor. Okay? What happens? Word now comes from Forminos. There came messengers from Forminos. They were Noldor and bore new tidings of darkness. They told how blind darkness came northward, and Melkor was there also. And Finwë, king of the Noldor, was slain before his doors. That's why Mondo said, you won't be the first. Just hold on a while. Word's coming. He already knew in his mind Finwë had been killed. Feanor stands up. He swears an oath. Okay. He says things against Manwë and such. And we have the Noldor leave. Before they do, we get this oath. That Feanor vows, this is several pages into that chapter of the Flight of the Noldor, Feanor vows to pursue with vengeance and hatred to the ends of the world Vala, demon, elf, or man, as yet unborn, or any creature, great or small. Notice, he'd have made a very good lawyer. He knows how to define his terms and to extend them out as far as possible. Much different than Frodo, by the way. We'll talk about that later. That time should bring forth into the end of days who should take hold or keep a Silmaril from their possession. So he's essentially damning anyone who ever claims a Silmaril if they are not blood related to Fëanor. Okay? And all of his sons agree. And Tirion, the messenger of Manwë, comes, tells the Noldor, don't listen to Fëanor. If you do, we won't stop you, but all hell's going to break loose. And what happens as the Noldor get ready to leave? They can't just take their nice little swan-like sailing ships and go straight across the ocean. What do they have to do? You have what's called the kinslaying.
Yeah, the Teleri say, no, not our boats. Those are our boats.
Those are our boats, mine, my precious. And so what do Finwë and his people do? They kill them and take the boats. So now the Teleri that are left, okay, among whom is someone whose name I mentioned previously.
Galadriel.
They now have to take another route to go back to Middle-earth. Turn for a moment to your map. Blast. Sorry, it's not on there. It's not on there either. I don't know if this will come up. Yeah, that'll work. PC, take, projector, on, screen, down. Okay, so what they have to do is they have to take the northern route. Since they don't have boats to go across the ocean that separates Beleriand / Middle Earth from the land of Aman and Valinor. Okay, so here's what they do. They leave from over in this area, and they have to come all the way over here into the wastes of what's called Fornost. And they come up here, and then they climb down. This is all Middle Earth. This is all Aman, also called Valinor. Okay? This row of mountains here. So it used to be possible to get from here to Valinor just by hopping on a boat and going down across, as long as the gods were favorable. Okay? Unfortunately, as we'll see very briefly on Thursday, what happens after this passage, okay, and this passage meaning the flight of the Noldor and the Quintus Silmarillion, after the Akalabeth, which is the downfall of Numenor, okay, what happens is Manwë changes the shape of the earth. The earth goes from being here, it's flat. The world, Arda, as originally created, is not a ball. It's flat. Okay? It gets changed into a circle. So that if you sail from here, where will you arrive? Over here. You can no longer sail unless you have either a specially equipped boat or a special person on your boat guiding you. You can no longer sail from here and arrive at the land of Aman. The one exception is, you know, at the Grey Havens at the end of the Lord of the Rings. But that's because there's a lot of people on that boat who kind of are VIPs, let's call them. Okay? That allows them to be able to go to Valinor. Okay? So, Fëanor and his guys come over this way. Now, where's Morgoth? He's up here. Sauron's up here also. But there are still other elves around here, and pretty soon men are going to wake up over in this area, and they're going to start making their way westward, okay? And so we get the flight of the Noldor, etc., and then we go back. Screen up. Lighting. Projector off. So we go back to the elves of Middle-earth, okay? And we talk about the Sindar, which is Thingol and such. Okay. The hiding of the sun and moon, the hiding of Valinor, the waking of men, return of the Noldor, and then we get a description of Beleriand and its realms, and you have another map, hopefully the same one is in your books, okay, which gives you the main areas. And it tells you where certain individuals lived. You have Thingol and Meli in here in Doriath. Notice down here, Círdan. Círdan the shipwright. The same Círdan who is at the Grey Havens at the end of the Lord of the Rings. Okay?
And then somehow managed to obtain a beard in the process.
He's done what?
He's got a beard.
He's got a very long beard. Yes, he does. We have the building of various cities and such. You have the passage of Maeglin. I'm skipping a whole bunch, which I really shouldn't do. Because where I want to pick up on Thursday is of the ruin of Beleriand. We're going to stop. Of the ruin of Beleriand and the fall of Fingolfin. Okay? And on Thursday, here's what I'm hoping to be able to do. We'll briefly discuss the ruin of Beleriand and the fall of Fingolfin, and then we'll talk about Beren and Lúthien, because it just has ripples all throughout, okay? And then we'll talk about of Turambar, because that's one of the greatest sad stories in Tolkien's creation. And the voyage of Irindil. We'll briefly talk about the Akalabeth. Okay? Very briefly. We won't talk about the Rings of Power in the Third Age, because we'll come to that in Lord of the Rings. Okay? So pretty much those three or four chapters that I mentioned, the Ruin of Beleriand, Beren and Lúthien, Turin Turambar, Voyage of Arendil, maybe if Tuor and the fall of Gondolin. Okay. All right. So we'll stop there.